creation is the process of transforming one thing into something quite different. Today we're going to transform an ideology worn cover into a keepsake album featuring pieces from Prima and Sandra Evertsen's Relics and Artifacts collection. Add in some texture paste and a little paint, and you have a piece worthy of a bride or anyone who loves pretty things. This project begins with an ideology worn cover number 93134 that has a horizontal orientation. As it comes from the package, it looks like this. Now it's packed flat, and when you get it, you take it out of the package and you just go ahead and you fold this part of where the cover adjoins the spine area, and it creates that typical journal. Now these come pre-punched, and they have the grommets on there, and you're going to use one of these. This is the ideology ring binder, and we're going to eventually use one of those to insert in this spine area in the section, in the center section, and that will allow us to put some pages in there. But that's putting the cart ahead of the horse here just for a second. We need to talk about this. Now, as you can see, that this is really, really pretty the way it is. But for this project, my idea was that the pieces, the relics and artifacts pieces, I wanted them to look like they were emerging from plaster. And if I turn this up, you can see that with the use of Ranger's texture paste, that it really is how this looks. So we need to take this cover and conceal all of this pretty stuff that's on there so that we can go with this plaster look. And what I use is just regular old gesso. Now you can see that there's virtually nothing left here. Now you can see a little bit of that design that's in the center, and this is about 3 coats of gesso. It does take a little bit of time, and I just kind of put it on there very randomly. I leave areas that are lighter, even though you can see this border on here. We're going to put enough texture paste on, and we can be very deliberate in where we put it to conceal all of this stuff. So what you need to do is get your however many coats. For me it was 3. Again, put on very loosely, get them on there and let them dry. And while that's drying, you can take a look. Let's just slide this out of the way for 1 second. You can take a look at the pieces. Now this set of, or all of these sets, the Relics and Artifacts collection from Sandra Evertsen and Prima, are just amazing. There's all kinds of pieces available. I'm very fond of the Ex Votos that have hearts with flames like this. I guess I don't need 2 flames. And there are a couple of different options for wings. You can see that there are smaller wings like this, and then there's larger, chunkier wings that I used here. I'm going to show you both of them. Now, as they come from the package, they are set with screw eyes in them so that you have an opportunity to do something and make them hanging if you want. Now, obviously, that's not what I want to do here, so you just have to use some pliers and go ahead and remove the screw eyes from all of the pieces. Now, the holes that are left are pretty tiny. Because I want my elements to look like they're emerging from the plaster, let me just bring this back in for 1 second. What I've done is I've put plaster and I've actually overlapped the relic, if you will, so that, again, it looks like it's coming from the plaster. Now, I haven't done it yet, but you can see right here, there's a hole. It's just a question of taking a little bit of the texture paste, putting it on there, and that will conceal that bit right there. Now, there's a fair amount of texture paste on here, but I did this in a couple of different layers. I wanted the opportunity to put it on there, let it dry, walk away, come back, and see how it looked. And I spent a fair amount of time getting the texture paste in all of these crevice areas because I really didn't want it to look like these were just plopped on the surface. So that's going to be the next step. I'm going to get myself sorted out here, and I'll come back, and we'll talk about applying the pieces to the cover, and I'm going to use E6000 for that, just because it's a super strong glue that bonds incredibly well. And then we'll talk about applying the texture paste. I've laid my pieces out and arranged them the way that I like them. Now, the one thing to bear in mind is that you're working on this flat, but you've got this spine area here. You want to ignore that when you think about how you want to lay this out so that it's centered on the front cover. When you work with wings, there are a couple of different options. Now, these are kind of in place, so I can't do too much with them. But you can turn, especially wings like this, you can make them more upward like this, or you can actually have them a little bit more horizontal. Because of the limitations on the width of the cover, I've had to go up like this. It's not like it's a compromise. I think it looks great, but I did want to warn you about that. So E6000, this is stinky stuff, so I only take the cover off long enough to actually put the glue on the piece. The one thing that you'll always notice, first of all, I put a little bit of Vaseline around here. They tell you to do that, and that kind of helps keep this from getting too messy. And you can see that it's already starting to ooze a little bit. So when you squeeze this, don't squeeze really hard or it will come out and it will want to keep coming out pretty much forever. It's very strong adhesive. As I said, it's kind of smelly, so if you're sensitive, go ahead and open the windows. Now I'm squeezing in the middle of the tube, and you can see that the product wants to continue to squeeze out or ooze out. So if you take it and you squeeze inward on the edges like this, that kind of helps draw the excess back in. Again, it's kind of smelly, so I'm just going to put the cover on this, put this to one side. If you set yours down, put something underneath it because they do dribble a little bit. So I've got this piece ready to go, and all I'm going to do is place it where I want it. Now, this is not an instant tack, so you do have some time to maneuver things. I've already adjusted the wings a couple of times. You can choose to move this in tighter if you want. Let me just turn that so you can see it. I kind of like there to be a little bit of space. Plus, if you make this too tight, it's next to impossible to get a finger or a palette knife in there to apply the texture paste. So I'm going to turn this back toward me. Now, ideally, you're going to wait until the adhesive, whatever you use, is dry. I don't want to have to do that, so I'm going to come back and show you putting the texture paste on. Now, you can see when you look at this versus, let me get the other piece. If you look at this, you can see that they're just kind of plopped on there. Whereas if you look at this, they are not plopped on there and they look like they're part of the piece. Now I need to come back in here with a little bit more texture paste. I need to fill in this hole and I also need to fill that gap in a little bit. This is what you're looking for, or at least what I'm looking for ideally, is that I have these pieces and they look like they're part of a wall, which is what I'm trying to represent. So you're going to just grab your texture paste. Now the nice thing is that this is very lightweight. By the time you add these pieces to this cover, it can get reasonably heavy. All I can tell you is to just put this on as though you're buttering toast or frosting a cake. Use a palette knife. I find it much easier that way. The initial time I did this, I actually watered the texture paste down. I've since determined that I don't think that it's necessary to do that. But as I turn this, you can see that I've started to close up that gap. And this is going to take multiple coats. I'm not going to get this all done at once. I'm going to keep playing with this till I'm satisfied with the way that it looks. And I'm also going to run the texture paste up the side of the heart a little bit. And I'm going to do this in a very rough fashion. I'm not looking for fine finish details. I want this to look like it's an artifact, like it's an old piece that I dug out of someplace, and this is kind of how it is now. So that's going to be your process. You're going to do that until you're satisfied with the way all of these pieces look. And as I said, you can run your texture paste up even into the wings, so like I just did there. If I bring that to you, see how I've got texture paste up here? I'm doing that quite deliberately. And I'm also going to spread the texture paste out much further. So if I have areas here that I think need to be camouflaged because of what's printed on this cover, the texture paste will go a long way toward helping me do that. So play, get it done, and then I'm going to come back once everything is dry, and I'm going to show you how you can then add some paint and maybe some glitter to this as well. I have added texture paste to this piece over several different iterations. I've put some on, I've let it dry, I've come back, I've put some more on. In all cases, what I've been trying to do is make certain that the elements don't look like they're perched on this cover, that they're, instead I want them to look like they're part of the cover, and as I said earlier, I want them to look like they're emerging from the plaster. And so with that in mind, I've gone around and I've added as much as I think I need to accomplish that. I've got some really great texture going on here, and I'm pretty satisfied with the way this looks. Now I can see a little bit of color here and I might have to fix that after the fact, but that's a small thing and it's not anything to worry about. So let me show you, my original prototype is actually finished now and it has gone from this to this. Now I'm going to move this in the light and you can see that there's some very subtle sparkle on the background. I used the tiniest bit of glitter. I'm going to show you that whole process now. And never have you made anything so beautiful using so few supplies. This is so easy and it's so wonderful. I'm going to turn this toward me. Now the thing that you want to do is make certain that whatever you use to adhere the pieces to the cover is long since dry and all of your texture paste is dry too. I'm going to bring in some Lumiere Pearl White. I had visions of this in silver, and ultimately when I decided to start playing, I ended up with this and I'm very satisfied with it. I think the color is just perfect. So I'm going to, I have a brush that's actually got some water and a little bit of this color in it. I'm going to put a little bit out on my nonstick craft sheet, and what I'm going to do is water it down quite a bit. I want a really thin wash of this, and I'm going to water it down a little bit at a time. That way, if I don't get into all of that, I can just pick it up with the brush and put it back in the jar. So all I'm going to do is brush this everywhere on this. Now, I've chosen to get a little bit lighter as I reach the outer recesses of the cover. You could not dilute this with water if you want. You go with it straight instead of a wash. That's entirely up to you. I like this very subtle look that I've gotten so far with just the hint of a little bit of glimmer, both from the pearlescent part of the Lumiere paint and from that tiny bit of glitter that I put on. So again, it's just a matter of, again, I want to lighten this as I get to the edges. It's just a matter of getting the Lumiere everywhere. It only takes a moment to do. Now, obviously, I'm trying to move along at a reasonable pace so that I don't take forever and you can move on to ultimately to doing this yourself and then the next steps. But it does take a moment to sort of get through all of this. And this is such a big part of the project that you don't want to make a mistake on it. So I am being somewhat cautious about that. You have my apologies if you think this is taking too long. I also put some of the Lumiere along the spine and on the back cover just for some continuity so that this piece looks the same. No matter which side you view it from, it all belongs to part, it all seems like part of a cohesive whole rather. All the pieces appear like they belong together, which is what I wanted. All right, so I think this looks pretty good. Now I'm going to apply the glitter while the paint is still wet, and what that's going to allow me to do is avoid a separate step and needing to put some glue on here. Again, if I want to put a little bit of the pearlescent color here, I can just kind of scooch this along. Same process for when you're doing this on the back. I didn't go for full coverage because, again, that's not what I'm looking for. So let me just scoop this up, put it back in the jar. Grab a piece of paper towel so that I don't make a mess here, and now I can slide this back into the frame. So in comes, this is the Elizabeth Craft Designs, is that right? Elizabeth Craft Designs, this is that unbelievably microfine glitter that is just beautiful, that works really well. This is the antique silver color. You could probably go with the regular silver if you want. This happens to be what I have on hand, so it's what I chose. Now you're going to see me take the tiniest little pinch of this. That's all I've got, and most of it's on my fingers, and I'm just going to gently drop this in various places and let this fall. It's so subtle that I'm not certain you'll be able to see it. Now here's the good news. If you decide you've got a blob in an area and it's too much, come back with a damp paper towel and you can pull it out. But I'm thinking that this is okay, the way that this looks, and so that I'm going to call done. Let me turn this toward you. Well, actually, let me do this first. I'm going to turn it over and knock it so that there any loose glitter comes off. Let's kind of clean that out of the way again. So if I am satisfied with this, I would just put it to one side and let it dry. But what I like is to kind of remove most of the glitter from the top face of the heart. I just think it looks better without it. That, of course, is a totally personal decision and something that you can decide when you make your own. If I think that that section right there is just a little bit too heavy, which I do, I can come back in and pull some of it out with a damp paper towel. It's pretty simple to do. So you can refine this so it looks exactly like your vision. And this truly is what I imagined. I kind of had this picture in my head when I started this project, and at this point I'm really, really satisfied with it. Now you'll note that this piece has the rhinestone chain on it. So let me quickly show you that. And then ultimately we want this to be a useful binder, and I'm going to show you the binder ring that you can put in here and the punch that you can use to punch your own custom pages, as well as the pages, the pocket pages that are built for this. So let's bring in this, this paint is dry enough. Probably all I need to do is make certain it's dry right there. So let me just grab this. I don't want to put adhesive on wet paint. That just is a recipe for disaster. I'm going to use my favorite. It's what I use all the time. In some place here is a toothpick I can grab. All right, that feels pretty good. So I'm going to turn this back toward me. I've already cut the rhinestone chain to fit. This is the piece for the top. Now this is Preziosa. It's Czech rhinestone chain and it's utterly beautiful. It's in a silver setting and this is a stretchable kind of thing. It will contract and expand. There's obviously a limit to how much, but that's going to allow you some flexibility for getting these pieces on there. So these are clear crystals in a silver setting. I think that that works really well with this look. I think that the raw brass just wouldn't have fit. And the larger version, this is the SS, this is 6.5, and I want to say that this is 14 maybe. You can see that though these would work. I like the very delicate look that you get with this smaller version. So it's a really easy process. I'm just going to apply some glue in a bead right along. There's, when you look at the flame piece and the heart piece of this Ex Votos, you'll see that there's a natural little place where this stuff will sit and just fits on there perfectly. So it's really an easy thing to do. All right. What I like to do is use my awl. Once I get this on there, it really does allow me. I have small hands and even my fingers are too big for this. So it allows me to come in here and move things around until I'm satisfied with the placement. Now I will tell you that on the first one I did, I actually got a fair amount of texture paste on this little rim on each of these pieces, and it proved a little bit challenging to get the rhinestone chain to lay in place the way that I thought it needed to. So on this one I was a little bit more careful and removed it. So you'll do that for the top and the bottom if you choose to add the rhinestone chain to your piece. And then it's a matter of assembling the thing, going to put pocket pages or regular paper in there and putting the actual ring binder in that will turn this into a book. I've completed the prototype. I have assembled the piece so that the ring binders are in place, but rather than use the brads that come with the ring binder, I've used a piece of ivory grosgrain ribbon. I'm going to show you that in just a second. But one thing that I should have said in the last segment, if you decide at some point that you got a little heavy-handed with the glitter, or if you decide that you don't want to use glitter at all, just use the Lumiere Pearl White. It provides an incredible finish all by itself. The glitter is just an added touch. But if you did get a little bit too much glitter on there, it's a simple matter to just create a thin wash of the Pearl White with some water again and go ahead over the areas where you think there might be too much glitter, and that will allow you to calm it down a little bit. So this is the ring binder. This is what opens up that you can put pages in. So let me show you how I put this in there. All right, so here is my second one, and here is the ring binders. They're packaged two per, and as I said, they have brads with them. So let's just pop this out of here. I'm going to leave the brads inside, use them, save them for something else. I don't generally throw these kind of things away. So here is the ivory grosgrain ribbon. This measures 3/4 of an inch wide, and what I want to do is feed this in through the hole that's here and pull it through, and then I'm going to do the same thing. I need to feed it through the opening in the ring binder. Now there is another way that you can assemble the ring binders in if you're not using the brads, but that necessitates going through each hole twice, and this ribbon is too thick to really get two of the passes through there, so this is the option that I'm going to use instead. And what I'm going to do is just feed the ribbon through the ring binder so it covers most of the binder. A little bit more through here. All right, so now I need to go back through this end and then back through. Now if this gets a little bit, as it starts to ravel, it can become a little problematic to fight with those pieces, so you just trim them off. And then again you go back through the hole in the spine of the book. Now what I like to do is make certain, first of all this is not even, but I want to make certain that the ribbon is exiting the holes really neatly so it's not twisted or funny, and I want to do the same thing in here, and I'm reasonably satisfied with this. If I think that that fold right there is a problem, I could back this out and flatten it with my finger and then pull it through, and that kind of cleans that up. And then you just need to decide how you want to tie this. Now I chose, let's bring the other one back in. I chose to center my, or not center my knot. I've got it off-centered a little bit toward the top, and you see there's no bow. All I did was just cut the ends of the ribbon. Again, this is kind of thick ribbon, so to create a bow that you would attach to this just got to be a little bit too much. So I need three hands to do this, and I don't have three hands, so what I'm going to do is utilize a little bit of glue. I have some glue on a toothpick off to the side. What I'm going to do is tie a square knot. So for me, that's going to be, this is right over left, and then this creates the first part of the square knot. And I'm going to, again, I'm going to push this one so that it's a little bit toward the top of the spine rather than center it. I like that look. So once I get this pulled up, I need to hold both ends of the ribbon, and then I'm going to come in with a little bit of glue. The problem with this ribbon, well, it's not a problem, but the thing with this ribbon is that because it's polyester, it's slick as heck, and it doesn't want to hold on to itself as I tie this. So just get enough glue in there so that you can know that this is going to hold itself in place. And then, now I have glue on my finger, very unhappily, so let me clean that off. So what I'm going to do is, again, I'm going to pull this up tight, I'm going to let the glue hold in place, I'm going to put my finger on there, and since I did right over left to start with, that means I now need to do left over right to complete the square knot. Although, quite honestly, with the glue, if you make a granny knot, it doesn't really make any difference. And again, this is the problem. I only have two hands. So you kind of have to work this until you get that knot basically in there and done. All right, let me get the glue off my fingers again. You can make last-minute adjustments if you need to, but I'm pretty happy with this. So what I'm going to do is make certain that it's tied up really tightly. There's a little bit of glue right here that I want to just clean off the spine. And then it's a matter of doing the ends of the ribbon. And I like to cut them on an angle. I like to do one in one direction. Let's see, that looks about long enough. And then the other in the opposite direction. I will tell you that if you try to do this with dirty, it's not dirty, sorry. If you try to do this with dull scissors, it's not going to work. So basically, here we go. This is what you end up with. And this looks a little bit long. I might come back and trim that again. So let's talk now about pages. Let's finish up with the pages. Part of the Ideology collection are these assorted pages. And when they say assorted, what that means is that the placement of the pockets inside of them, there are a variety of them. This is the TH93140. And these pages have been punched with that ring binder in mind. So what you can do is you just take them out. Go ahead and pop open the binder, and then you can simply slide your pages in, however many that you want. It's that simple. So here's the thing. If you think that you don't want to use page pockets, you wonder what's your alternative. Well, you have plenty of options in terms of what else you can do. This is 140-pound watercolor paper. And this is Tim Holtz's Ideology Binder Punch. It has this little arm on it that you can slide one in or out. And what that does, here's your center mark, is it aligns the paper so that it perfectly punches. Now, I've already done this one. It perfectly punches the holes for use on this ring binder. So if you decide that you want to create pages out of something, for example, like watercolor paper. You know what, let me back this out a little bit. If you want to use something other than watercolor, if you want to use something other than the page pockets, you absolutely can. 140-pound watercolor paper makes a great page. It's just sturdy enough so that it's got enough body. You can add liquid to it and it's not going to be a problem. Now, obviously, I would do the pages outside of here, but nonetheless, it's a great option. So this measures 6 1/4 by 8. I couldn't quite remember there. If you cut your pages to 6 1/4 by 8, they'll fit perfectly in here. And when you close this, you can see that the page ends just in here. So it's really done well. Again, coming back to, we have two different options on the wings. This is what's available in the Relics and Artifacts collection. I love the way that this looks. I'm really, really happy with the outcome. I think that it's quite elegant, and I think that it would make a wonderful wedding gift, or it would be a nice option to give to a friend or anyone that you think, or yourself, anyone that you think would enjoy this.